Our chalice lighting today is from the Reverend Gene Wallstrom, who says, "In this small flame dwell the beacon light of lanterns guiding travelers home, the warmth of hearth fires tended through the generations, the transforming energy of furnaces, the power and life of the sun. May these blessings, warmth and light and life-giving energy, be kindled this day in each of us."
Good morning, and welcome to River Road Unitarian Universalist Congregation. I'm Reverend Amanda Weatherspoon, your associate minister. Welcome to our Live from the Sanctuary service. Good morning to those of you watching on YouTube Live. Good morning to those of you who are watching later the recorded service on YouTube. Good morning to those of you who are watching on the podcast. Wherever you're watching from and wherever you're watching from, you are welcome here this morning. River Road is a community of spirit, community, and service where we do bring the fullness of who we are in our conflict, in our trials, in these incredibly tough times. This is a space that we gather once more. If you're new to this community this morning, please send us an email to membership@rruuc.org after the service so we can properly greet you. This first Sunday in December brings us into a new worship theme. This theme of stillness shows up in the midst of the challenges and the chaos of this world. Every year, December is a month full of busyness, full of the hectic strain of the end of the calendar year, of the holidays, of so much, and this year, ever much so. But how we invite stillness in our hearts, how we welcome stillness into our homes, into our community, matters so greatly in these times. So as every year before, and every Sunday this year, as we gather through our screens, through our phones, through this technology, we also gather with our hearts. And in this morning, as always, come, let us worship together.
Good morning. I'm Chris McCann, your religious educator for children. When my daughter was 3 years old, I read Dr. Seuss's The Lorax to her for the first time. Justifiably upset by the destruction of the environment in the book, she shouted, "Mommy, this is not peace." This became a catchphrase in our home. Anytime my daughter noticed a shift in calm or witnessed an injustice, "Mommy, this is not peace." When my daughter was six, there was a violent crime in our normally quiet, peaceful neighborhood, and it shattered everything, especially my daughter's sense of safety. In the days that followed, I found myself relentlessly pacing our home late at night, my head filled with thoughts that happen too frequently, even now, in COVID times. Thoughts full of anger, grief, and a sense that someone should pay. This is most definitely not peace. One of those late nights, my warm home could no longer hold all of this furious pacing, and I thought to go outside into the cold December night. Not seeking peace, rather seeking air to fuel my fire of anger, grief, and sense of vengeance. In the backyard of my home, there was a fresh blanket of snow lit by a bright, not quite full moon. The fire in my mind, the collection of "this is not peace," suddenly ceased, replaced by my grandmother's voice reciting from "'Twas the Night Before Christmas." The moon on the breast of the new fallen snow gave luster of midday to objects below, and what to my wondering eyes should appear but a fox, jumping from the woods over our fence, silently scurrying across my yard in that luster of midday night. I watched as he made his way across the other side into my neighbor's yard, and there I saw it. Something that I always knew was there but had never really noticed. A simple, hand-built, decades-old, weather-worn shrine to the Virgin Mary, illuminated by that moonlight on that snow. I stared at her for a long time. You might even say that I adored her. Mary has never loomed large in my theology, but that night what I saw was a mother who legend tells us was surely struck by thoughts of anger, grief, and a desire for vengeance on behalf of her child. That night, under that moonlight on that snow, she stood, arms raised in blessing. All was calm, all was bright. The whole scene played in my head, the snow, the moonlight, my grandmother, the fox, and Mary. I was stunned into peace. I've carried this story with me for all of these years, and there are times in the midst of the cry, "This is not peace," that I can recall that stillness. I can feel the cold air and see that scene unfold, and for even a brief moment, I can access that peace. My hope for you in this season and in all the seasons to come is that you may be stunned into peace and carry it with you for always.
Here at River Road Unitarian Universalist Congregation, where we have indeed kindled this light of hope, we prize connection over perfection. We are humble enough to know that we work with the tools we have when we have them to bring the kind of community that our hearts need so badly. And so, here in this place, we gather together with the music and the spirit and the words and the joys and the sorrows and the laughter and the tears. We gather in all the ways we can in a season of waiting. Here, in Advent, a time where we celebrate peace. Yes, even in the midst of seeming chaos, we gather. We bring the peace we have found We bring everything that is most definitely not peace in this day and in the experiences of every day. We bring all the strategies we can find to build peace within and without and make room for the joys and the sorrows that make up a day and make up a life. We gather today grateful for birthdays. Matthew Hollingsworth, happy 18th. We gather in the struggles of a lifetime for the diagnoses we cannot unknow and for the beauty we cannot see. We gather in gratitude and with open hearts and with great love, holding up those members of our own beloved community currently struggling with and emerging from COVID-19. We light our candles and say our prayers and think our deepest thoughts and work the work of our own hands for all those loved ones far away who have made it through, for all those who have not. We light a candle for the progress organized people of goodwill can make when we work together toward the greater good, for all the food put before those who are hungry, for all the effort given to building a new way, and for the holiday season. Yes, this holiday season, which is upon us still bright and beautiful, where we will gather before the festival lights yet again. We light a candle of joy that we will gather once again for Christmas Eve. In this safe and distant way, we will gather to light the light in our hearts. Next Sunday, our music service will bring the strains of hope and of joy to us once again. So mark your calendars for next Sunday and for Christmas Eve, where in the safety of our homes, we will, in spite of it all, find some illumination. Until then, we light a final candle for the work of our hands, that we may bring about the coming of the light in the midst of chaos.
This is a giving congregation. This is a congregation that serves and works with several community partners. Many of you know this. We have community partners that we've been working with for a number of years. We have community partners that are new to us. This is a congregation that engages with its full heart, with its full self. And in this season and in this time, it is needed now more than ever. Many of you have seen the announcements in the eWeekly and from this very pulpit about the Better Angels Collection Drive. The Better Angels Collection Drive is a part of our Potomac partnership. This is going to be done with Cedar Lane Unitarian Church. It's just down the street from us. Many of you have friends and acquaintances and loved ones in that community just as you do this. So next week on December 13th, we will gather once more as a collective body to collect a number of things for those in need, those directly impacted by COVID-19, by economic distress, by political unrest, those who are in need, those who are in this community. We will have a joint collection drive with Cedar Lane. At 1 to 3 p.m. next week on the 13th, Cedar Lane will have a drive, and we will have a drive, two drives simultaneously from both locations. This will be socially distant, as it has been in the past. This will be a time for you to drive through and drop off goods for those in need. We'll be collecting primarily for four organizations. We'll be collecting food, canned goods, for Manna Food Center, located in Gaithersburg. This is an organization that provides a food bank for Montgomery County. This is a far-reaching food service, and this is a long-standing partner at Cedar Lane Unitarian Church. This food bank serves people from all over this county and beyond, and we have the opportunity to be a part of building that food bank for those who are food insecure and scarce in our community. We'll also be collecting holiday gifts for Beacon House as well as La Clinica. Many of you here at River Road know all about Beacon House and La Clinica. These are long-standing legacy partners here at River Road. Each year we do a gift collection, and this year is no different. These are toys and gifts for those who are in need. This is something that can brighten up a child's day. This is something that can make the holidays a little brighter for those who might be severely lacking in this time. And finally, we'll be collecting gift cards, food cards from Giant and Safeway for the organization To Be Well Fed. To Be Well Fed is a nonprofit that comes directly from members at River Road. This is a nonprofit that provides food to kids at schools over the weekend when they have food insecurity and scarcity. And in these COVID times, that is even more so increased because many kids aren't able to physically go to school. To Be Well Fed will distribute these gift cards along with their other care packages that they distribute to families in need. So you have four ways to give in very big ways next Sunday, December 13th, from 1 p.m. to 3 p.m. here at River Road. You can drop off canned goods and non-perishables. You can drop off holiday gifts. You can drop off gift cards. You can drop off one or all. All goes towards helping. All goes towards building the beloved community. All goes towards living into our values. For more information, you can check your e-weekly. There are additional drop-off times throughout the week for those of you who can't make it next week. Check your e-weekly for those details and that information. And if you have any questions, if you'd like to help, if you'd like to jump in on any of the many social justice projects happening right now here at River Road, shoot me an email at aweatherspoon@rruuc.org. Once again, what we give helps build the world that we want to live in here and now, and we are needed now more than ever. I now invite you into a time and a place of presence, of stillness, and of prayer. And this morning I want to share with you a prayer for the holiday season by Aaron Payson. Oh, beloved, can it be that another year has passed? Wasn't it just yesterday when we heard such familiar music? When these well-worn stories awakened us from our post-harvest slumber? Wasn't it only weeks ago when we last reminisced about seasons past? When life seemed easier? When this season was so full of snowy wonder and glorious wants? Didn't we converse about how much there was still to do and how short the daylight hours had become? Wasn't it we who sat together then and sipped warm cider, or was it hot chocolate, and laughed as we shared again the memories of youth that gleam once again from our eyes? Or was it coffee and ruminations about a world gone mad? And hadn't we just made the promise that a year hence we'd be farther along than we were and far more accomplished in the doing? Those perpetually elusive resolutions that prove us kin and effort and siblings in spirit. Oh, beloved, can it be that we are here again? How incredible, how miraculous, how excellent. So let us give thanks for this heartfelt return. You have been so much a part of each other's lives, whose presence means fullness of joy and love, you who were such a gift. Let old stories be shared again with new insight, and new adventures add spice to the routines of our existence. Let life's milestones mark for us the forward path to possibilities yet imagined. And our trials and tribulations give us deeper appreciation for the blessings bestowed. The world is deep with its challenges, and it's needful of this, of communities of memory and hope, of a people of courage, with love deep enough to speak truth to power, with humility rich enough to make us mindful of the privileges we have not earned, and with a conscience broad enough to demand those rights that ought to be acquired to all people. Let the light we kindle spark the awakening that is ours to embody. For the truth we seek is the life we lead, and the love we share is essence of that peace for which we yearn. Amen, and blessed be. Each week at River Road, we have the opportunity to give generously of our hearts. Every time that we give, we know that we build a community that is big enough for each of us, that we share with each other the piece of this community that keeps us strong as we keep this community strong. As always, there are many ways to give here at River Road. You can pop on to our website at ruuc.org/giving. There you can learn more about giving. You can learn more about what that means to sustain this community as we sustain one another. And you can also learn about the different ways in which you can give. Of course, you can always give online right there, the amount that you choose. But you can also text to give. The text to give number is 73256. Once again, that number is 73256. Plus RRUUC, plus the amount that you would like to give. Wherever you give and whenever you give, what you give helps build this community to be such an integral part of this world and our lives as we are part of it in this mutually beneficial, dependent, beautiful relationship as this community of faith that does so much in the world through each one of us. As this music plays, please give as you are willing and able.
Thank you.
One dreary early December in 1994, the renowned collector of stories and author Pico Iler, he found himself on a pilgrimage up and into the San Gabriel Mountains outside of Los Angeles to meet and to interview a hero of his youth, a legendary figure who loomed large in his mind and his heart, a man who had come to retreat from everything when, in fact, he seemed to have everything at his fingertips. This man, the object of Pico Iler's fascination, indeed his deep reverence, he had come up to a literal mountaintop to take vows at the Mount Bradley Zen Center after committing to spend 5 long and lonely years as a personal assistant to the Zen masters in that place. After taking these vows, after committing to this seemingly endless silence, the man whom Pico Iler was coming to meet was given a new name in the Dharma, in the way that he would move forward in life. They called him Jikan, which is Pali for silence. But you would know him as Leonard Cohen. Leonard Cohen, who wrote of all the broken hallelujahs. He who wrote of how those cracks in everything are what lets the light in. He who called us to embrace the holy imperfection, the brokenness at the heart of time, Leonard Cohen, who once said that the interior of his own mind was, quote, very much like the waiting room at a DMV, that Leonard Cohen was the man who had chosen to escape it all for 5 years in service only to silence. Days and nights in a bare hall, sitting still, doing nothing, going nowhere, looking at the same 4 walls over and over and over again, and in the process, Cohen said, experiencing something he had been chasing after his whole life. In Iler's book, The Art of Stillness, he writes about one night that December, at 4 in the morning, actually, in a pre-dawn day, Leonard Cohen looking like a hermit with a scraggly beard and a sock cap, climbed up to the writer's cabin. Jikan came to speak in just those few moments about what it meant to live in silence. Like so many of us who have perhaps less overtly dramatic circumstances, Cohen told the author that all his life he had been chasing experiences, and that underneath it all, what he was really chasing was the experience of something real, something unvarnished, something not curated or managed or performed, something fully true through music and poetry and rock and roll, through privilege and wealth and every single thing an embodied person can feel. He chased that thing, only to find at 61 years old that, quote, the profound and voluptuous entertainment of my life, the real feast laid out before him, presented itself only when he finally learned the art of standing still. What else would I be doing? Cohen said there in the pre-dawn darkness of yet another day in the same place, doing the same thing, going nowhere. What else would I be doing? He asked. Buying more expensive wine? What could be more voluptuous than this? He asked, gesturing to the cold night air. What could be more entertaining than for once going absolutely nowhere. I am not now, and never have been, good at going nowhere. For that matter, I have never been particularly good at silence. In fact, back in the before days, when we gathered here in this sanctuary together, committed to holding deep and sacred silence, to hold our joys and sorrows close with only the squeaking of the chairs and the sound of our intake and outtake of breath, when we held those minutes of silence in this place as a worship team, we learned real quick when I first arrived that Cliff had to be the one to hold those ticking seconds of silence each and every week, not me. Because if we left it to me, if we left me as the steward of the silence, I would always, always cut it off early, twitching with anxiety about the empty airtime, feeling the weight of responsibility to fill it, not later, but right now. And so Cliff, he times our silence. He'll do it again right there from his piano bench because I feel safer if he holds it. And perhaps I am more able to create a safer space for all of you. Silence is not a natural medium for me to create anything in. And yet for most of my life, in these strange little commas and punctuation points along my ever-talkative way, I have tried to slow down long enough periodically to listen for the voice of the holy. That is how I was taught to pray in the tradition that raised me. Benedictine sisters and Ignatian Jesuit priests, they teach you to center down and to wait in that place for the holy to speak. So I have done the things. I have visited sacred places. I have gone to my own small mountain tops to try to get away from it all. I have shut myself among sisters dedicated only to a life of service. Before the kids were born, I even booked myself a 3-day silent retreat, completely by myself, no phone, not even a novel, good God, just me, no one to talk to, no one was listening, apparently that was my job. And every time I have tried to center down long enough in silence to hear the very voice of God, I have to say that the response has not been overly resounding, my friends. No great callings, no great and astonishing clarity, no blanket forgiveness for my own small sins or flashes of insight that make every single thing abundantly clear. No, none of that. Not even an idea for the next great American novel. All I have ever gotten in response to the silence I can muster are the 5 words I gave as the title to this sermon. Be quiet, child. Be quiet. That's it. In a convent, in a sanctuary, in an ancient place of worship, in this place we make sacred together, that is all that the holy has chosen to say to me over and over again, though I tread the footsteps of real life, actual saints, waiting for something more dramatic. Be quiet, child, be quiet is the whole message, like God, clearly a parent figure in my imagination, is telling me to knock it off already and shut up for a hot minute. And if that is all God ever has to say to me, perhaps it will always be enough. Because after all, I am not that good at silence. Are you? I think about the statement that Cohen made. about how the interior of his resting mind, most of the time, yes, even whilst atop a mountain in a Zen monastery, the interior of his resting mind was something like the waiting room of the DMV. It's a little laconic. It's slightly funny, you know, but I don't think that Leonard Cohen meant it as a joke. Consider the Department of Motor Vehicles, if you will, and I know I am asking a lot of you to meet me in that unpleasantness. Consider the Department of Motor Vehicles in the before times previous to the pandemic. What's it like in there? It surely is not calm and peaceful. The highlight is the interminable waiting, yes, but also the hurry up that leads to the waiting, the frantic scrambling for the very important documents upon which all things depend. There are the nervous teenagers taking their driving tests. They are ebullient when they've passed them. They are dejected to the point of tears when they have not. There is the anxiety of the vision test as we squint one more year to see the letters that hold the key to independence and mobility. There is the wounded vanity of every single driver's license photo, all in a profoundly strange context in which nobody wants to be stuck where they are, and everyone is constantly headed someplace else. So much energy and emotion and anxiety crashing up against itself. And when I think about it, that crashing feel of emotions and anxieties and hopes and dreams and disappointments, that is not entirely an unfair description of my pre-pandemic inner monologue either. 1,000 feelings, 1,000 joys and concerns and hopes mashing up alongside each other inconveniently in a waiting room that never seems to end, and a pursuit of something that is never to be found exactly where you are. No one among us chose the way things are today. No one among us chose the precise measure of retreat from what we came to know as normal, which these times have demanded of us. Certainly no one among us who feels isolated or alone or hopeless in these days chose that state like some privileged rich rock star choosing to retreat up a mountain for 5 years. No, we did not choose this, but we are here nonetheless, in circumstances quite different than the ones we knew before. We are here. We are going nowhere. With the world unfolding all around us and within us, we are here. Sometimes the silence that comes when we did not choose it feels anything but voluptuous or entertaining. Sometimes it is frightening. Often it is claustrophobic. Usually we try to push it away. And it occurs to me that silence, especially the kind that we experience over long periods of time, it might itself be a kind of relationship with stages and phases like any relationship. There is the coming to know it, the fighting against it, the slow resolving of tension to rest a while alongside it. At first, when confronted with extended periods of going nowhere, with extended periods of silence in our lives, at first, when confronted with that inactivity, we cannot let go of the humming buzz that life was before. We try to get it back. Perhaps we then choose to push away the silence with a constant stream of digital noise. How many of us have done that during this pandemic season? At other times, the silence weighs down on us like a blanket we cannot remove. We are exhausted by it. We want nothing more than to shake it off. And at other times, even when there are no big dramatic answers to our big dramatic questions, perhaps the silence itself becomes an experience of the sacred. Perhaps the non-doing becomes the doing of something, and a new kind of richness emerges. Perhaps all of these stages repeat themselves over and over and over again, resenting it, pushing it away, drawing it close, finding wonder within it. Perhaps that is just as well. As Pico Iyer wrote when reflecting later on that interview with Leonard Cohen, going nowhere, it isn't about turning your back on the world. It's about stepping away so that you can see the world more clearly and love it more deeply. We have been forced out of the anxious waiting room of our lives and placed within the same four walls for a period of time we did not choose. I suspect we are, in fact, entering the long, hard winter that all the people on TV say we are. Our people are often far away from us. The way forward is not always clear. But there is a voluptuousness to existing in one place. There is a way of seeing and of being that is not available in the crackling to and fro that preceded these days we are given right now. There is a kind of entertainment in the silence that is stronger than the anxiety so many of us, including me, bring to most quiet spaces. So when we are able, and when we are not creating new noise to drown out the quiet at the center of things, perhaps we too might find that heaven is wasted on the dead and choose to find the moments of wonder that are happening right here, right where we are, especially when we are going nowhere at all. Be quiet, child. Be quiet. It is all that God has ever had to say to me. Stop talking for a moment and listen. And may the listening bring its own kind of wonder. May it be so, and amen. Thank you, Cliff. Thank you, Reg Jackson on the saxophone. Thank you to our tech team for rolling with it through it all. And now, may the truth that makes us free, the love that casts out fear, and the hope that never dies guide us and those we love and those we do not love forward together, till the day spring breaks and the shadows flee away. Amen.